Hello. Today we shall learn some of the fancy yarns. Before learning any of the fancy yarns, we'll first see what are the types that are there, how we define fancy yarns, and what exactly are fancy yarns, how they are different from the regular yarns. So let us take a look at the normal yarns versus fancy yarns. The objective for a normal yarn is to provide as regular and as parallel as possible an arrangement of fibers twisted together to form a continuous length of uniform thickness. Now, when we normally produce a yarn, we expect the final or the output yarn to be regular and parallel, and we have all the fibers that are arranged in a parallel manner inside the structure of the yarn. And that is what is the normal expectation from whenever we produce a yarn. But on the other hand, when we see that there are slubs, neps, or thin places in these normal yarns, and when we see them, it is noted as a fault and an imperfection, and these are actually degrading features of a yarn of normal quality. Therefore, a great deal of care and effort is taken to minimize their occurrence by preventing or removing these features wherever possible. In the fancy yarn production, however, there is a difference that these features, whatever is viewed as a fault or an imperfection in a normal yarn, are deliberately introduced into the yarn along with color to give visually and texturally attractive differences to the fabric. Some yarns that might be called fancy yarns have only color changes as distinctive features, which are obtained by a number of techniques such as twisting together different colored yarns or spinning irregularly blended dyed fibers or even sometimes printing slivers or even sometimes going to the extent of irregularly printing already spun yarns. And such color effects can always be introduced into the normal yarn, and they may be called as a type of fancy yarns. So, how do we define a fancy yarn? Fancy yarns are those in which some deliberate decorative discontinuity or interruption is introduced of either color or form, or of both color and form. This discontinuity is incorporated with the intention of producing an enhanced aesthetic effect. So, as you can see over here, these are some of the examples of fancy yarns. It's a picture of some fancy yarns. And these yarns would, when woven into a fabric or knitted, they would give a sort of enhanced aesthetic effect. So this is majorly done to have some kind of interest in the look of the final fabric. The significant market segment for fancy yarns, we can see these yarns are applied normally in ladies' outerwear. Occasionally, they are also used in men's jackets, knitwears, and ties. One example would be this particular garment. Hand knitting is a popular end use, mainly for ladies and children knitwear. Fashion designers also use fancy yarns as a means to diversify style. So this is another way it may be used. Furnishing is also an important market area, particularly in curtains and blinds, wall coverings, and upholstery. So even in these areas, we find a large use of fancy yarns. The basic structure, let us go to and have a look. The basic structure consists of the core and the effect yarn. So as we can see over here, we can see the core component, which is shown in blue over here. And then there is one more component, which is the effect component, which is shown in black. And there is a binder component shown in red over here. So let us see what are all these elements that are there that go into the making of a fancy yarn. Most of the fancy novelty yarns are complex ply yarns. Now we should remember that this would normally be a ply yarn, but the moment we introduce certain texture and certain textural features into the yarn, they tend to become or be called as a fancy or a novelty yarn. Basically, it's a ply yarn. So the basic structure of a fancy double yarn is that it consists of three components. The first component is a core or the core threads, which is also known as ground yarn or foundation yarn, and it imparts a strength to the yarn. The second is an effect material that is shown in black over here. It's the effect, and this is the second component. To obtain a structured effect, a longer length of effect component relative to the ground components must be present to form the required feature or effect. So to make this particular fancy yarn, we might require a longer length of effect component as compared to the ground components, because the effect would normally be projecting out of the structure of the base yarn that is being made. So this extra length has to be provided during twisting. The buckling and twisting of the effect component onto the ground component produces this aesthetic effect. So now we come to the third component of this particular structure, and which is known as a binder yarn, which is shown in red. And in more complex cases, as you go on making a complex fancy yarn, we would require one more component into the structure, and which is called as a binder. So a binder which, as the name suggests, ensures that the entire structure holds together. The twisting of the binder around the assembly locks the feature in place. So the moment you use a binder, it will lock whatever effect the effect component has produced on the surface. As a binder must wrap around the yarn, it needs to be overfed. The amount of this overfeed depends on the yarn count and the effect being produced. So this binder yarn would also require some amount of overfeed, because it has to wrap itself and keep the effect component in place. But then it will always depend on what kind of yarn we are producing. A greater amount of overfeed is needed for thicker yarns and for yarns with more pronounced effects. So if your base is quite thick, then you would require more amount of length of binder yarn to keep them in place. Or even if the effect is more pronounced, even in such cases, we would require longer length of binder yarn to keep the effect in place. It is usually around 4 to 11%. The binder yarn should generally be as inconspicuous as possible. That means it should be as invisible as possible, and it is usually less than 50% of the total ground yarn thickness. We can also observe that whatever ground yarn thickness is used here, the binder yarn would be a much more finer one, almost up to the extent of 50% as compared to the ground yarn thickness. A fine colorless filament yarn may often be used as a binder in order to reduce its visual impact on the completed yarn. So one thing we must keep in mind, that the binder yarn is only necessary to keep the effect in place. We do not want it to be a part of the effect, and that's why it should be as invisible as possible, and therefore a colorless filament would be an ideal choice here. The choice of the binder color can materially affect the saleability of the yarn for a particular purpose. So we should see to it that it does not affect the look or the appearance of the final yarn. So the binder yarn must be something that that is not visible, and if it becomes visible, then it might affect the saleability of the yarn. So coming to the classification or the types of fancy yarns that are available or that are there in the market, can be actually classified in the following 8 basic profiles. And those are spiral, jimp, slub, knob, loop, cover, chenille and snan. So out of these, some of the effects, fancy yarns, we are going to see in this particular lecture, and the remaining effects we will see in the next part of the fancy yarns. Now each of these yarns are having different effect variations, and they are called in many different ways, like spiral can be mock spiral, jaspe, then slub yarn again could be made in a variety of ways, and they have different looks and looks to it. Same way loop yarn, although this is the basic structure, it may be called as boucle at times. Then there is even chenille, which are woven chenille as well as plied chenilles. And then there are these snarl yarns. So we can have this variety of basic yarn profiles along with some kind of effect variations, which will be termed as or called in different by different names by different manufacturers, or they may slightly differ in their looks, but the basic structure would be that of the basic yarn profile that is given here. And so with this background, we shall go further and see. These yarn effects can be made by plying a number of yarns together or with modified spinning techniques. Most can be spun from sliver or even from roving. So as and when we study each and every yarn structure, we shall see the differences that are involved, and we shall try to compare each one of them with the earlier yarn that we would have studied. So with this background, we go to the first type. Although this was not mentioned in the 8 basic types, this is one of the basic, say, fancy yarns that are produced, and the most simplest ones, which is known as a marl yarn. So the simplest of the fancy effects, a marl yarn in which two yarns of the same count and twist but of different colors are folded together. That means they are plied together to form a balanced yarn. So as you can see, this is the most simplest structure. You just have, it's a ply yarn basically, but instead of having both the singles yarn of the same color, we are using either of different color or maybe sometimes of different counts and twist, so as to give us a sort of different effect in the look of the yarn. And this is how the yarn would look, having two different colors. These yarns are used to good effect in discrete pinstripes for men's suitings, or to produce a subtlety and irregular pattern in the knitted fabric, using a relatively simple fabric construction. So if you have a simple plain knitted fabric, just to create some amount of interest in the look and feel of the fabric, we may use this kind of yarns. So marls may be produced on ordinary doubling frame or by the ring spinning system. Both these systems can be used to produce a simple marl yarn, because there's not much complication in this particular structure, because we are just using two different colors of a singles yarn here. So coming to the first basic type of yarn, which is the spiral or the corkscrew yarn. Two single yarns of appreciably differing thickness and twist levels and direction. All these three factors all put together, or maybe one of them each, are plied together with a slight overfeed of the coarser yarn. So there is a slight overfeed of the coarser yarn here, which will give you the texture on the yarn. So this is how it will basically look. These are the different spiral yarns that are produced. A mock spiral can also be produced, in which both yarns have the same twist direction but applied with the reverse direction of the twist. So if you have two singles yarn which are having the same twist direction, say Z, and if they are plied with a reverse direction, that is say S, so in that case the spiral effect is much less pronounced. You will have some kind of spiral effect over there, but it will be less pronounced as compared to the normal spiral yarn, because twist is removed from both the yarns during the plying action, and the surface fibers of the fine yarns become slightly intermingled with the coarser yarn, and therefore it diminishes the visual contrast. So you should always try to see if you want to have a larger effect of spirality or a spiral yarn over here. We must see to it that not only the thickness change in thickness in the singles is there, but also the twist levels and also the direction. If they are differed to a certain extent, then we get a more pronounced effect in the spiral yarn. So let us go to the just basic understanding of how a spiral yarn is produced. A spiral or a corkscrew yarn is a plied yarn that displays a characteristic smooth spiraling of one component over the other. For one yarn to spiral around the other, there must be an excess length of one yarn. This is very clear that if we want one of the yarns to spiral around the other yarn, one of the yarns that we are using should be either fed in excess, or automatically during twisting it should create some amount of excess length during plying. So it must be produced by one, it may be produced by one of these several methods that are shown over here. So if equal lengths of say S and Z twist yarns, single yarns, are combined with a twist either S or Z, so what we are basically doing is taking two singles yarn of opposing twist and then combining them or doubling them with either S or Z. So in this case, suppose let us take one example and say that we have chosen S to be the plying twist. Then in that case, the component that is a single yarn which is S twisted over here, that would be still further twisted, whereas the Z twisted single yarn would try to open out, and which will provide the extra length for making this spiral yarn effective. So that is what is being said here. The component to which twist is added will contract in length, while the other will extend and spiral around the outside of the yarn, thus formed. This produces an unbalanced twist twisted spiral yarn. So coming to the next method of producing this kind of yarn, if equal lengths of two yarns, one coarse and the other fine, are folded or plied together with a twist that opposes the thick yarn twist. So what we are basically doing is we are taking one two yarns, one is coarse, one is fine, and the thicker yarn twist we are taking a plying twist which is opposing that of thick yarn. Suppose thick yarn twist is say S over here, then the plying twist would be Z, so that the thick yarn will open out and provide the extra yarn that is required to form the texture. The thicker yarn will therefore appear to spiral around the thinner yarn. So this is another way of enhancing the effect of the spiral yarn. So coming to the third method, that is one or the other of the two yarn components. So if you are using two yarn components to make the spiral yarn, then one of them may be delivered at a greater rate. The shorter length forms the base, and the greater length of the component that is being overfed, that will form the texture, and it will spiral around the base yarn. So this way we can produce the spiral yarns. These are the three methods. So coming to the next yarn type, that is the jimp yarn, it looks something like this. So the textural properties of a jimp yarn are clearly greater than those of spiral and are therefore different. So jimp yarns are somewhat similar to spiral yarns, which we will see in a short time how they are similar and similarly made actually. But there is a slight difference that these have a greater textural effect, as you can see here, and that's why they are termed differently and called as jimp yarns. Jimp yarns, another major difference is that it will require a binder and are therefore produced in two stages on the ring spinning system. In most cases, these yarns are used to create subtle textural or color effects. In particular, spirals and jimp offer the opportunity to create the finer textural yarns, which can be of particular use in woven fabrics or fine summer knitwear. So both spirals and jimps are used to create this interest in the woven fabrics. So a jimp yarn is a compound yarn consisting of a twisted core with an effect yarn wrapped around it so as to produce a wavy projection on its surface, which is similar in description to the spiral yarn that we have just studied. Since a binder yarn is needed to ensure the stability of the structure, the yarn is produced in two stages. Two yarns of widely differing counts are plied together, thick around thin, like spiral yarn. So basically, first stage is to produce a yarn which is a spiral yarn, and then the above yarn is reverse bound with the binder yarn. So this is how this enhanced effect is produced. Reverse binding removes most of the twist inserted during the first process. It is this removal of twist that creates the wavy profile, and it makes the effect yarns longer than the actual length of the completed yarn. So the effect yarn would open out, that is basically the spiral yarn that we have used in the first step, that would open out and create this enhanced effect, giving us this jimp yarns. So coming to the next similar type of yarn, which is the boucle yarn. These yarns belong to the group that also includes jimp yarns. So they are almost similar, we can say. So, but still you can see a different look here of this boucle yarn. Let us go ahead and see how they are made. The effect is achieved by the differential delivery of the effect component as compared with the core yarn. So we have seen in spiral, while making the spiral yarn, we have three methods of making them. In making of the jimp yarn, where we are using we are making the spiral yarn by using say different directions of twist and using that spiral yarn to produce a jimp yarn. Here in this case, in boucle yarns, what we are doing is we are using the third method of making the spiral yarn, that is by using the differential delivery or the overfeed, and we are making a highly enhanced spiral textural effect of our spiral yarns, and such yarns we are using to make the boucle yarns. So this slight difference is there between the structure of boucle and jimp. The effect component wraps around the core yarns either tightly or loosely according to the amount of excess delivery and the level of doubling twist inserted. So in the basic spiral yarn that we are going to use to produce boucle yarns, we will have excess delivery during the making of spiral yarns. and then we will have used this spiral yarn to make this. These wraps are then partially untwisted by the final plying operation. Just like jimp, there will be binder yarn which is used to have the final plying operation, and during which the original spiral yarn that we have used here will open out slightly and give you this enhanced curves which are bound by the binder yarn. So having seen this, let us see and highlight the differences that are there between jimp and boucle. The effect is similar to jimp but more pronounced, with the effect yarn more loosely wrapped around the core. So this we have seen. The other way in which the boucle effect differs from the jimp is that jimp always employs yarn as the feed, while the boucle yarns may be made using either yarn or sliver as feedstock. So one may use either yarn or even sometimes sliver is used to produce this boucle effect. Unless the yarns that we are using is very very heavy, the yarn effects, that means the boucle yarn produced by using the yarns as the base, would create a lighter, crisper feel than that where we are using either sliver or a roving as the effect yarn over here. So with this difference, we come to the next type of yarn, which is the loop yarn. And a loop yarn consists of a core with an effect yarn wrapped around it and overfed, so as to produce almost circular projection on its surface. So as you can see in the sketch over here, we have this effect yarn producing perfect loops on the surface of the yarn, and this is the image of the actual yarn that is produced. So as a general rule, four yarns are involved, of which two form the core or the ground yarn, and the effect yarn or the whatever yarns we are going to use to create the effect of loops over here on it, that is being overfed by almost 200% or more, and it is important that these be of the correct type and quality. That means it should be even, it should be of low twist, it should be elastic and pliable yarn as far as possible to give you this perfect circular loops on the surface of the yarn. The effect yarn or fiber is not completely entrapped by the ground threads, and therefore a binder is needed. So once this effect is bound onto the ground yarns, this loop can shift and these effects can come together at one position, and it might the ground may look bare, and that's why it is very important that there is a binder yarn which is able to keep the loops in its position. So the size of the loops may be influenced by the amount of overfeed. So if we feed instead of 200, maybe 250%, the loop size will increase over here. We can also change the loop size by changing the spinning tension or the twist level of the effect yarn. So by doing this, certain small changes, we can change the size of this particular loop. Loop yarns may also be made by using slivers instead of yarns for the effect. So again, just like boucle, we can use maybe slivers as a effect yarn and produce this kind of yarns. So if the effect yarn is neither particularly stiff nor particularly springy, it makes the loops inconsistent both in size and its formation. Rather than creating neat circles, they fall lengthwise along the yarn to form ellipses. So we must understand that the effect yarn is very important here, the nature of the effect yarn, and it should be stiff enough, and it should also be springy enough to produce those perfect loops. Otherwise they will just fall and form ellipses on the surface of the yarn, and does not really give you the look of the loop yarn. So in this situation, it is found that mohair fibers makes particularly suitable yarns and is therefore often used for this purpose. So mohair loop yarn, we can see that when you use viscose, when you compare here, it has almost fallen, all the loops have fallen lengthwise and they form ellipses, whereas mohair, when we are using as the effect yarn, it gives you perfect loops on the surface of the yarn. This demonstrates clearly the benefit of using mohair in loop yarn formation. When it is desired to create an effect which requires distinct loops rather than simply an exaggerated boucle. This yarn almost looks like boucle yarn, which is an exaggerated effect over here. So that is why if you want distinct loops, we should see that the effect yarn is perfect. As the loops are clearly isolated by lengths that appear simply be plain yarns, the fabric will not have the blurred effect of a boucle. So since the fabric, when you compare it with the viscose loop yarn over here, if you were to use both of them in making of a fabric, the fabric produced by this particular yarn, where we are having perfect loops, will have a different look. It will not have a blurred effect, because the loops will be distinct, and there will be between two loops there is a plain yarn which can be seen, and it will not give you a blurred effect, which we will be able to observe if we were to use this viscose loop yarn. And both these yarns will give a different look to the fabric. So there is a different extra process that is involved over here, which can produce brushed loop yarn, which will just be the means that it will be opening out these loops, and it will give you this kind of a look in the yarn. A fluffy but smooth feeling yarn is produced by brushing a mohair loop yarn. So if you were to brush this, you would get a more fluffy or a smooth feeling, but there will be no more loops in this particular structure. So coming to the next structure, that is the snarl yarn. Like the loop yarn, the snarl yarn is based around a twisted core. Similar to the loop yarn, we are having a ground yarn, and there will be an effect yarn which is the snarl, which is giving the snarl effect, and there will also be a binder in this situation. A snarl yarn is one which displays a snarls or twist projecting from the core. It is made by a similar method to the loop yarn, but it uses as an effect yarn a lively high twisted yarn and a somewhat greater degree of overfeed. So both these conditions are important, where you will have a twist lively yarn used as an effect yarn, and at the same time we are having a slight overfeed just like loop yarns to give you this effect. The size and frequency of the snarls may be controlled by a careful control of the precise details of overfeed and the spinning tension, and by the level of twist in the effect yarn. So by controlling the overfeed and the spinning tension, we may change the size and length of the snarl that we are getting on the surface. So let us come to the point where we should understand what is the difference between the loop yarn and the snarl yarn when their productions are almost the same. The feed system for snarl yarn production is the same as it is for producing loop yarns. Indeed, the main difference between loop yarn and the snarl yarn lies in the properties of the effect yarn. So the major difference that is seen in the effect is not because of the production method, but because of the type of effect yarn that we have used. A twist lively effect yarn will tend to produce a snarl effect, while a low twist level in the effect yarn will produce a loop yarn. And if the yarn is, of course, if it is sufficiently stiff, or simply if it is not stiff enough, then it will simply give you a exaggerated boucle effect. So these are the different changes that are there when you produce these three different types of yarns, that is snarl, loop, or whether your effect is going to be a boucle type. To create a snarl yarn, the effect yarn should have a relatively high level of twist, which will facilitate the formation of the small effect, the snarl effect. The overfeed ratio is also higher, that is 250% as compared to the 200% that is used for the loop yarn. And with this, understanding the different types of yarns that we have seen today, we come to the end of this session. In the next lecture, we will see exactly how these are produced, what kind of mechanisms we need on the normal, say if we were to use a ring frame, what are the changes that are required to produce these particular yarns, what are the stages that are required. We will also study certain alternative spinning methods which we have already learned, like hollow spindle, how they can be used, and dref also, how they can be used to produce these fancy effects or fancy yarns. So that will be covered in the coming next lecture. So thank you very much.